So Big Mom's pirate ship is arriving, and Big Mom forms her alliances through marriages, and Kaido and Big Mom are making an alliance. Then Kaido has a special announcement that relates to his son, and that must mean... What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to my channel. In this video, we're going to be discussing a theory that involves a lot of stuff. It involves Katakuri and Marco and the Whitebeard Pirates arriving in Wano. It also involves another wedding. This time it will be a Wano wedding. And, by the end of this theory, it's really my prediction of how the Wano arc will go and complete and conclude, and how it will set up the next generation of pirates and Yonko, and just how Kaido and Big Mom will be defeated. But before we jump into the theory, we must look at the information that we have, and starting with the most recent stuff, which was One Piece chapter 979. If you haven't seen my chapter review, I'll put it right up there. Check it out. I mentioned some of this stuff that I'm about to mention. And the most important stuff that came out of that chapter, I think, the big reveal, was Kaido's son's name, Yamato. Now, I mentioned, of course, in my chapter review, but Yamato, we could look at different inspirations that it takes from. Of course, it could take from the famous battleship, the World War II Japanese battleship that had so many cannons, and it was just this pure thing of destruction that was very dominant, right? So it could be an inspiration drawn from that, showcasing Kaido's son having this great strength. However, I don't think that's the case. While it could be in like another symbolism aspect of like if he is strong, I think the direct inspiration is coming from a historical Japanese figure called Yamato Takeru. Now, this makes a lot of sense to me in multiple ways. First of all, Wano and Kaido's crew and like Orochi and just everything in Wano in general has taken a lot of inspiration from Japanese culture, history, legends, folktale, and all that. And Yamato Takeru fits right into that. So if we look at Yamato Takeru, he was a prince of the Yamato dynasty, and his father was the Emperor Keiko. Now, it's not like his name is Kaido or anything, but now we have Emperor Keiko and his son Prince Yamato, and we have Emperor of the Sea Kaido and his son Yamato, probably kind of like a prince in that way, right? So that right there, direct correlation. Of course, you have the Japanese aspect to it. But if that wasn't enough, Yamato also has a special sword that he has called the Kusanagi no Tsurugi. And this sword has a lot of relations to the inspirations Oda has taken for Wano. This sword was taken from the tail of the monster Yamata no Orochi, which is the inspiration for Orochi's devil fruit. And also the person that killed that monster, Yamata no Orochi, Susanoo, he killed it with the sword Ame no Habakiri, which is the sword Momo has. So it all kind of wraps together. So I think Yamato Takeru really fits, you know, the theme of Wano and the inspirations Oda has taken. So I think this is important because we can now look at the story of Yamato Takeru and kind of draw some conclusions and see where Oda could take his inspirations from. So to start off, Yamato Takeru is a very strong person, and he also has a very cold personality. Now, one of the most famous stories about him is that he killed his older brother. So pretty much, to skip the boring details, his brother like disobeyed his father, wasn't listening to him, and his father was like, "Hey, Yamato, go check on your brother. Go talk to him, make sure he's following his duties and all that." And then Yamato's like, "Yo, I got you. I'm gonna go check on him." So he went, came back. He's like, "Listen, I talked to him. I gave him a stern warning. However, I tried to rough him up, but I'm too strong and I accidentally killed him." So, you know, this is your inspiration number one, is that Yamato is this brutally strong, very cold personality, and that could be the personality inspiration for Yamato in the story. Now, after this, the Emperor Keiko was actually very terrified of his son Yamato, so he sent him off. He's like, "You know what, you go do this mission for me, squash this rebellion," and I just sent him off. And then so Yamato goes to squash this rebellion, and he successfully does it, but he does it by cross-dressing. So now we're learning a little bit more about him. He's kind of this like devious planning kind of person. Although he's very strong, he's not like just brutally attacks everybody in that way and that's how he wins all his battles. He's also very scheming and devious. So there you have possible inspiration number two, where Yamato is not only just strong, but he's also this like devious kind of person, and maybe that relates to why he's hiding on Onigashima, why it's difficult to find him. And then the third final inspiration I found interesting was that Yamato, once he defeated the rebellion, he went back home and he was like expecting this great welcome, a warm welcome, especially from his father, like celebrating him for his deeds. But he didn't really get that. His father saw him. He's like, good job. And now go do another mission immediately. And Yamato was really affected by that, right? Despite the fact he was very loyal to his father and obedient and had this cold personality, he was really expecting to be like celebrated and like given a warm response from his father. But he didn't get that. As a matter of fact, he went to his aunt and he was like, aunt, auntie, why is my father treating me like this? He's not giving me the warm welcome that I expected, and he sent me off to on another dangerous mission right away. Does he want me to die? Is like the most famous thing. And this is like the tale of a tragic hero, essentially, because Yamato never makes it back home again. Before he returns from his next mission, he dies of a sickness. So that's like his tragic tale, where he's this strong warrior that always followed his father but never received that warmth back. And I think this is the biggest inspiration that Oda could take, where Yamato is this ridiculously strong person and he's the ace of Kaido's crew, and he's like the strongest there. Of course, we've seen Kaido's crew is like based off meritocracy, where survival of the fittest, and like, you know, even if you're Tobiroppo, if you defeat a calamity, you could take over. It's all about strength. So maybe Yamato is the strongest of the crew, and his father gave him that position, but just never gave him that father-to-son bond that he was looking for, that warmth of a family, like treating him like as an actual family. He just sent him off on missions and kind of used him as a soldier. So I think this would be a very interesting aspect to draw from. So taking this possibility comes the first part of my theory, and that is that Yamato is this super strong guy, but he's underappreciated by Kaido. He's really just used as a soldier, and then most recently, he kind of just gave up on it. He stopped following his father's orders, and he's just kind of doing his own thing, and that's why, you know, he's not around too much, and Kaido is not, like, he knows his strength, so he's not, like, gonna, like, try to kill him or anything. And we saw in the most recent chapter, Kaido is very chill, actually. It's just to the stronger members, right? He's still the top dog, but, like, you know, even Ulti was flipping out, and he was pretty chill about it. I think he could have that same kind of attitude to Yamato as well. So maybe Yamato is just like this neglected son, and he just doesn't feel loyalty to his father anymore. He's just kind of doing his thing off on his own. So that's part one of the theory. Now, the next thing I want to mention is a possibility of a Wano wedding. And, you know, when Bao Huang showed up, she gave us that schedule of everything and what is about to happen. It might seem like a very, like, standard schedule at first, but there was a lot of important information in there. The biggest one was, you know, the formal announcement of Big Mom and Kaido's alliance, and also Kaido's special announcement afterwards. This one, the special announcement, as far as we know, all we know is it is something to do with Yamato, and if he announced it before the alliance, it wouldn't make a lot of sense. Now, this, I think, is a wedding. I think it makes a lot of sense because we saw how Big Mom does her alliances. It's a big part of Whole Cake Island. You know, she sells off her, not sells off, but she uses her daughters and everybody else to, like, form alliances. Like, she tried with Lola, with the Giants, Pudding, with the Vin Smokes. Like, that's how she operates her alliances. And I don't think Kaido and Big Mom alliance will be any different. So, you know, that could be the special announcement. Now, you may be saying, why wouldn't it make sense if they announced that first? You know, a marriage and alliance would make a lot of sense. Doesn't really matter which order they go in. With this, I think it's important to note that not all the Beast Pirates know of the Alliance. Just some of them and like the very top dogs know about this. A lot of them are probably even confused why the Big Mom Pirates are on Onigashima and like not fighting with the Beast Pirates themselves. So if they announce marriage first, they could be very confused. And especially if Kaido is marrying off Yamato. Say Yamato is this very strong person, like the ace of Kaido's crew. They would be like, why would you marry off Yamato to Big Mom's pirate crew when he's the strongest, like your strongest soldier? Like, why would you lend that power to Big Mom? And another thing to tie back into this is I think it's important to look at why these two entered alliance in the first place. Like, why we saw them go battle and they came back and they're like, okay, we're in alliance now. We don't know what happened there. Why exactly did they enter alliance, right? I don't think they would do that for no reason. They both have something each other need and would be beneficial to each other. So first off, Kaido for Big Mom. I think it's been shown in this arc, Wano arc already, Kaido has a bigger crew. He has more foot soldiers. He has more battle power. His commanders are all stronger. Katakuri is the strongest Big Mom's crew, and his bounty is like lower than Queen's, right? And so we have Queen, King, and probably Ace. Yamato might be all stronger than Katakuri there, right? So Kaido has a lot of power, so Big Mom might want that power from Kaido. Now, what could Kaido want from Big Mom? I don't think it could just be that debt, or otherwise Big Mom would just like be like, you owe me a debt, lend me power for now. Kaido definitely, I mean, Big Mom has something Kaido wants. And then I thought about this for a while and it came to me. Big Mom has one special person that has the potential to read Poneglyphs, and that is Pudding. And Pudding just had a failed wedding. And you know, and now she could be used for this wedding. And she's a very important to Big Mom. But maybe Big Mom could use Kaido's like power. And Kaido also has races that she wants with King and possibly a giant with like Black Maria. So that's another thing connecting there. So, and then Bao Huang, one of the things that were mentioned was that Big Mom's pirate ship is arriving. And I don't think that means the one that was already on Wano, because earlier on, Queen was hyping up the Big Mom pirates, kind of insinuating that they were already there. So maybe now Katakuri with Pudding and everybody else is coming to Wano, and they're here for this big wedding between Yamato and Pudding, and now this kind of ties the last two arcs together. Remember, this is a Yonko saga, right? Why have this Big Mom come to Wano and not make it like a bigger connection to each other? So now if we have this wedding that links together Whole Cake Island and Wano perfectly, you have Pudding and Katakuri characters we learned about in depth in Whole Cake Island and kind of grew to love a little bit, and we're bringing them back into the story and tying it all together. Now, originally I thought about how Wano was gonna go, how, you know, Luffy was gonna defeat like Big Mom and Kaido, and I thought maybe Big Mom just leaves. That was my top guess. But if this wedding happens, I could really see this war that has been hyped up to be this grand war, like huge, epic war. It could be that level now. With Wano wedding as a theory, I think the conclusion of Wano arc could actually lead to the fall of Big Mom and Kaido now. Now, you might be thinking, how does that change anything? Because I think Yamato and Katakuri, who's potentially coming and Pudding, they're kind of be shown to be Kaido's side to make them stronger. But, you know, with the whole Wano having the theme of betrayal and Yamato possibly having resentment with his father and Katakuri, who I'll talk a little bit more about later, they could both turn on Big Mom and Kaido later on and actually add battle force to Luffy's side. So Yamato, I already talked about, you know, he's maybe has resentment against his father, and maybe this wedding would be the final straw for him, and he just turns on him, and eventually he, you know, leads the Beast Pirates in the future or something. I think the Beast Pirates aren't that loyal. It's been shown that Kaido just rules through strength, so I think it's very possible more of the Beast Pirates follow Yamato and betray Kaido. On the other hand, Big Mom leads in a similar way. You know, she's ruling by fear, and you know, maybe Katakuri turns on her. So I think it would be very ironic in that way, where you have two Yonko falling for, you know, just poor leadership. Kaido, who rules all these strong people by strength, but you know, gets betrayed because it's all about strength. On the Big Mom side is that, you know, she wanted to have this big family, but she really wasn't treating them as family. And then in the end, she has family turn on her, and leading that charge would be Katakuri. And Katakuri arriving in Wano would be very poetic, in my opinion, because we learned so much about him in Whole Cake Island, what kind of person he is. He's kind of like, you know, the family person that Big Mom is not. Of course, he's very loyal to Big Mom and like follows her orders and like protects her and everything. But it was shown that Big Mom still treated him like any other son. Like during the wedding, she was like, Katakuri, what are you doing? You're my son. You don't call the shots. I do. Right. But Katakuri is like the protector of all the siblings. Like when it was possible, when Big Mom died, when she fell in the waterfall, the Big Mom pirates were already discussing like who would lead if she died. And Oven said Katakuri because he's the strongest. I think a lot of people would respect him as a leader. And he's really shown to be that caring family member that Big Mom is not, right? He cares for every single sibling, like not just like the stronger ones or the people closer to him in age. All of them he cares about, right? And especially like Brulé, we saw that backstory and everything. He was concerned about Perospero when Perospero got blown up by Pedro, right? He cares about all of them. So he could be that perfect next leader for the Big Mom Pirates. And now why would he turn on Big Mom? You know, at the end of Whole Cake Island, of course, we had that whole thing with him and Luffy. He said, hey, you're gonna come back and defeat Big Mom, aren't you? And then he's like, what? Luffy said, yeah. And he's like, wow, you're looking really far into the future. And almost like felt like a hopeful wish that he had, because Big Mom, you know, doesn't really care about her children. She marries them off just for her political advantages. She would kill them without any hesitation. So maybe Big Mom, you know, does a thing in this war and really hurts one of, like, their siblings. What if she, like, kills Brulé? Probably won't happen, but what if she, like, cripples Brulé? Something crazy like that. And Katakuri has had enough and he turns on her, right? And then the tide starts turning. You know, Yamato goes and fights his father, right? So this idea of betrayal with Yamato and Katakuri coming to Wano, but actually they're on Luffy and the pirates and the samurai side. I think that would be a great way to take this war and escalate it to the next level. Now you may be saying, sure, Yamato could be super strong. Katakuri could rally some Big Mom pirates and turn on Big Mom. It's still not enough. And that's where the Whitebeard pirates come in. That's where Marco is coming in hot. And, you know, I think it would make a lot of sense. Because why isn't Dekomamushi here, right? I think if he's really just coming back by himself, empty-handed, it would have made a lot of sense storytelling-wise to just bring him in when we really had that moment. It's like, oh, Denjiro, we got him. Oh, Jinbei's back. Ooh, Nekomamushi too. It just would have been right at that moment. Why have him just come back later by himself? I don't think it's that impactful that way storytelling-wise. However, it would make more sense if he does come back a Whitebeard pirate. Now, last time we saw Marco and Nekomamushi, Marco's protecting that village that Whitebeard had protected and used his, like, the money he had saved up to protect essentially war refugees, because that's what Whitebeard was, right? So Marco was talking to Neko, was like, oh, Weevil, you know, he's on a rampage. I think he's gonna come after me and this village next, so I gotta stay and protect it. The conversation ends with Marco saying, go and tell Luffy a message. He's in Wano, right? And the conversation just stops right there. And that leads me to believe that the conversation had just begun and Marco did not know the specifics of what was happening in Wano and Odin's story. You know, there was a lot of, like, curiosity of why Whitebeard or Roger or Shanks, none of them did anything to help Odin's tragic death. But remember, Wano is, like, super isolated. Maybe they know Kaido took over Wano. Maybe they know Kaido is there and he rules over it. But they might not know how tragic of a death Odin suffered. Not Oda. Oh, God. Oda, stay alive. Do not suffer a tragic death. We need you. But Odin, you know, maybe Odin also told them, don't worry about it. This is my place. So they saw Kaido go over and they're probably like, Odin still got it. Kaido rules it, but Odin's probably fine. But, you know, maybe Whitebeard pirates don't know about this story. Marco doesn't know about this story. And in the anime, it actually expanded on that scene a little bit. Of course, anime is not canon, but sometimes they, you know, just they take the story and expand it a little bit because Oda just doesn't have the time to expand upon it. And it's just one quick little add-on where Nekomamushi says, we're going to take down Kaido. And Marco has this, like, super surprised look. And so, like, if he knew Kaido killed Odin and gave him this very tragic death, he shouldn't be shocked by this. He should know Nekomamushi was super loyal to Odin and would want to take out Kaido that as one of his goals. So maybe he just doesn't know this whole story. And he hears about all this and he's like, okay, so we lost Whitebeard, our pops. We lost Ace. We lost Thatch. We got destroyed by Blackbeard. And we lost with Weevil's messing us up. And now the one person pops told us to protect, Luffy, is going up against Kaido, and if we help him out and we protect him, we possibly get to avenge one of our brothers, Odin, who was on the crew with us. And so now he learns the story. Maybe he's inspired and he wants to go help Nekomamushi go to Wano and help him out there. And that message he wants to give Luffy could have been like, yo, don't think we forgot about Pops' message. I'm a little occupied right now, but, you know, later on, if you ever need any help, take this Viva card or something, like, give me your Viva card, I will come to your aid. Maybe now, like, he just forgets all that. And he's like, okay, I gotta go protect him now. Now you might think, what about the village then? Important thing to note is that the Shichibukai system was demolished and, you know, Weevil was being attacked by the Marines last we saw him. So maybe, you know, Marco finds out about that. He's like, okay, we got a little bit more time. Let's go gather up our crew. You know, Jozu, Vista. I would love to see Vista go there. And of course, Izo. Come on. Izo, we had such a highlight on in Odin's flashback. And he was one of the loyal retainers of Odin, so much so that he went on Whitebeard's crew with him. And I don't think, you know, Izo would be somebody who finds out about Odin's death and not go, right? I think the fact of the matter is, he just doesn't know the situation in Wano because it's isolated. So, you know, he goes there and he could have a reunion with the other retainers. That would be great to see. I think it would just make, it doesn't make sense that Izo, at least Izo, should go to Wano. And I think it all ties together to why Negomamushi hasn't shown up yet. The lasting conversation with Marco, the fact Weevil is being chased by the Marines, and, you know, if it, this Wano wedding becomes a huge thing and, you know, everybody is showing up, I think this could be really that big war. Whitebeard pirates show up, Yamato turns and betrays Kaido, and Katakuri betrays Big Mom, and now you have way more fighting power on the Straw Hat side. You know, as of right now, it's really still really hard to see Luffy defeat Kaido with the rest of his crew just because Big Mom is there. How do you defeat Big Mom as well? If it was just Kaido, sure, right? And, you know, it's a numbers disadvantage for sure, but through sheer strength and power, they might be able to do it. But Big Mom and the Big Mom Pirates are also there. How do you take them out unless she leaves? And that was my original thought. But if there is a wedding happening, I really think this whole big war getting escalated, Whitebeard Pirates showing up, and the betrayal happens, and, you know, it just all ties together that way. So that's my theory, and, you know, in a way, it sets up the next generation as well. You take out two Yonko, but you also have Yamato, starts to rise on his own. Katakuri takes, like, the new Big Mom Pirates or something, or the Katakuri Pirates, and you kind of start to get into this next generation a little more. Now, I don't think there's going to be, like, Yonko, per se, in the future, because Luffy would just become the king, but there's still going to be very well-known strong pirates, like Kid, Law, I'm expecting Yamato, Katakuri, you know, that's just the kind of the next generation taking over. But yeah, that's it for my theory. Let me know what you guys think about it in the comments below. If you have any theories yourself of how Wano is gonna go, any predictions, or, you know, just how Luffy and the Straw Hats will defeat Big Mom and Kaido in general, let me know in the comments. But as always, thank you guys for watching, and I hope you enjoyed. If you did enjoy, please hit that like button, and it helps a lot with the YouTube algorithm, so smash that like button. And if you wanna keep up to date with when I'm posting and when my next video is gonna be up, you gotta hit that subscribe button. Guys, we're keeping it rolling. I'm loving your support. Thank you guys so much. We're probably, by the time this goes up, I might even be at 80 subscribers already, right? So every video I've been jumping like 10 subscribers. This time we might jump like over 20. So, you know, hit that subscribe button. Let's keep it going. Next goal is 100. Let's get there. Hit the bell as well to join the squad. And don't forget to follow me on Twitter. I'm TheKing4, and I'll see you guys next time. Peace.